The best part about boating projects is that nothing goes as planned. So it turns out the alternator won't charge the batteries at all, for some reason. Got that one cable, you know, the one cable that you should have bought, but you didn't when you were in the shop. Here it is, I have it. So the time has come to do the lithium upgrade that a lot of boats do these days. We have three reasons for us to do this. The main one is that our old house batteries, they were actually completely drained out and we had to throw them away for the season regardless. So we needed new batteries. Secondly, we're getting solar panels as well. So we need a solar regulator and something that works well with the new batteries. And then thirdly, we wanted to install an inverter as well to get some proper 230 volts on the boat. And all these three things together made it quite easy for us to choose that lithium is a way to go. So now I've finally received three different packages here that I've been waiting for quite some time. So this first package, it is the actual batteries. This is what the battery management system looks like. Some cabling and wiring. And these are the actual cells. This is a 3.2 volt lithium phosphate cell. And it has a rating of then 280 amp hours or a capacity. 3.2 volts, that's not a lot. That's why we have four of them. You connect them in series and you get a proper 12 volt battery. And since we're installing solar as well, we needed some regulated device as well. So trying to find the most cost efficient way around this, we managed to find a device from Renogy, which is really good. This is Renogy's 50 amp DCDC charger. So it connects to my lead acid bank for the starter batteries. It connects to my lithium bank to charge them. It connects to the solar panels and it has a built-in MPPT regulator. And also it connects to the alternator. It can actually charge from alternator, shore power, solar power, and it can charge both the starter battery and the house batteries with a single device. And the maximum rating of 50 amps is perfect because we have 50 amps of solar power at peak and we have our alternator is also 50 amps. So this really is exactly what we need in one package. And also we have the inverter that we're going to use from Renogy. It's a 2000 watt pure sine wave inverter. Also has a AC input. And it's capable of switching over from shore power. So if I connect the shore power here and my consumption here as well, it will switch over whenever I have a loss of shore power and start using the lithium bank instead. It's quite big though. So the problem now is where to fit all these things in the boat. Let's start tearing it apart and see where we can fit these in. First out, I'm going to attach the cables to the BMS. And the BMS, it looks like this. So this is the JBD BMS. It's quite common in DIY projects. It has a connection for the battery. And we have some connectors here, which will be then using this harness, will be connected to each of the individual cells here. So these are four different cells. They will be connected through this harness to the BMS, which will then monitor each and every one of these cells to make sure everything works as expected. We also have a Bluetooth module that I can attach to the BMS if I want to do some monitoring. The minus pole here will be the minus pole for the entire battery pack, and I'll connect a bus bar between these two, and these two, and this will be the plus pole of my battery packs. So this will be plus, this will be minus over here. First out, crimping the cables here. The best part about boating projects is that nothing goes as planned. And you know it from when you start that what's going to go downhill this time. So yeah, I made it all nice and tidy and realized that I had to move everything around. So yeah, time to undo all the pretty work and do it once again. So this was the original spot for my batteries, where I assembled everything and thought it was looking nice, but then I had to move it over here instead, meaning that I have to undo all this harness for the BMS and so on. But yeah, you know, that's boat life, right? Everyone loves it. I think I'm done. Well, at least sort of wiring up as much as I can, but there's no need to do that until I have a charger. So now I'm going over to the Renogy DCDC charger instead. And the plan for the DCDC charger is to go down here. So this part here is a battery isolator diode. So if I clean this part up, I should be able to fit the Renogy in here, which basically connects to the negative, the house batteries, the starter batteries, and the solar panels. And this should go in here, is the plan. At least we'll see if I can get it that way, if or not. Oh, it's a mess. This is gonna take forever. Abo. And as always, when you do boating projects, something screws up. So at this point, we have M6 holes on all the cables for the charger, for the alternators, and to the battery banks and so on. And we got M8 on the Renogy DCDC. So yeah, why not just drill a hole, dig a hole. And there we have an M8 instead. Now, yes, it's a little bit less metal, about two millimeters, to be fair. But the connection surface is still quite large. That's also a bit of a problem. So this is the state of things right now. The DCDC is tucked in here. Not a very fancy cable job right now, but it fits very well. And all the batteries are connected. All right, got that one cable. You know, the one cable that you should have bought, but you didn't when you were in the shop, and then you had to spend another hour to go there to get it. Here it is, I have it. So now I have all the cables needed to complete this project, and hopefully I will be done in an hour. So that means in boating world, I'll be done by midnight. That leaves me about 6 hours. So yeah, let's go. So as I mentioned, this BMS, it has two inputs, really. And this is because each of these lugs can only handle 80 amps. So that's why you need two. And for that case, I'm using two 35 millimeter cables and with a bus bar, connecting them on each side of the bus bar, making sure that the power going from here will actually be divided into the two cables in the best possible way. So I'm gonna attach these, plug in the BMS and the power here, and then we should have a fully functional battery pack here. So the BMS and the batteries, they're all good to go, waiting for me to connect them, but first I need to tidy up this stuff a bit more. The DCDC needs to be properly connected, and that's better to do without all the power plugged in. I'm quite hungry and I need water, but I need power to get these things. Well, I can actually cook food, but I don't have any water. Because I don't have any pumps, because I don't have any power, and the power's over there. I'm thirsty. I need a beer. I wonder if there's any left since before. There we go. Oh, it turns blue. That's pretty much it. Now for one more connection to be made. The bus pole. Oh, I'm feeling super positive today, boss. Let's get some tools. A proper hylsnyckel. Let's do this. There we go. That's it. Let's do this. House batteries. Oh my god. Let's get some of that fresh water. Let's get some music going in here. Finally, it's still a mess. It's a bloody mess in here, but it works. The sun is still out, so so it's not night yet, and I haven't had dinner or food or water or anything, but things are working out the way it should be. So, yes! So it turns out the alternator won't charge the batteries at all, for some reason. There is one wire sort of left over from this whole wiring procedure, and I don't really know what did you call it? REP, rep. So when I connect the REP signal wire to the smart output on the Renogy, I get a lot of charge. So I just started the engine. There's no charge there. There it is. It's increasing now as it regulates up. Oh, that's not good. So that's 22 amps for the engine batteries, but also at the same time we got 26 amps going to the house bank. So I just tested it. It gave me 55, 57 amps of charging to both my battery banks, even at the lowest RPMs. So that's good. Yeah, easy peasy. It's time to get these three solar panels up on the arch. Since this is an aluminum frame and we're going to attach it to a stainless steel arch, we need to place something in between to prevent corrosion. And we're gonna use these rubber pads in between. They'll make sure that we have a distance at all times between the two metals. So when doing projects like this, you always have to make sure that the kids are well entertained. And one way of doing that is by sending them over to the both neighbor to help them pump up their dinghy. That's Adrian in his finest, trying to pump up the whole dinghy by himself. Hey, Adrian. Yeah. Hey. Now all the solar panels, they go down through the arch now, down to one of the lockers, and down here they all come out. We have six cables coming out, and from here we got to get them all the way to the Renogy DCDC converter at the nav station. I'm going to connect them in parallel, all three of them. So instead of having six wires going from here, I will convert it all, connect them in parallel, and go with two cables from here all the way to the nav station where the Renogy is. So now we're indoor and we're going to take the cables from all the way from the cockpit locker to go to the Renogy here, the DCDC converter, which is in the nav station. So down here in the nav station we have the DCDC converter. It's not only handling my regulator or alternator, it's also doing the charging from shore power and solar regulator as well, to both the lithium and the lead acid bank. So that's, I covered that earlier, it's a real perfect piece of equipment for me. It does 50 amps from different sources, and I have a total of 600 watts of solar, meaning 50 amps. So it's spot on to what I need. And now we're gonna just hook up the solar panels here and it should be just ready to go. As always with boating projects, that's usually the way it goes. It's just, you just connect it and it just works. No. Guess what? It wasn't as easy as planned. But I actually found an old GPS cable that I wanted to get rid of anyway. So I'm going to use that to pull through the hose. And a good thing to do while pulling cables is actually adding these lines so that the next time you want to get a cable through there, you can just use the lines. So I'm trying to, whenever I run a cable through some hosing or through wherever, I just add some lines so that I can easily pull the cables through at a later point. And now hopefully this is the last piece of the solar panels. So by attaching this to the common ground, the Renogy should realize that there's a solar panel hooked up to it right here and start to charge my batteries. Good luck. Oh my god, look at that. It's red. So now we can see that we have a red indicator. I wonder what that means. I hope it means charging, but I really have no idea. I have to check the manual. So now we installed the solar panels. We have 600 watts of solar together with the DCDC from Renogy. We're now gonna extend the whole package with an inverter. So here we have a 2000 watt inverter from also from Renogy. This one has a transfer switch, which means that I will also plug in the shore power here, and all my electronics on board will be powered through the sockets here. And in the case of the shore power is pulled out, then it'll automatically switch over to lithium instead. And with this, we'll be able to drive a quite a lot of things. It's a pure sine wave inverter, so all the chargers and the delicate electronics will work perfectly. And we can also run a cooking stove or microwave oven. We'll see how much we can do. But first thing, I'm gonna put this somewhere in between this whole mess here. And I don't want it to be occupying a lot of good space, so I'm gonna find a real tricky spot to fit it in, as always, and it's gonna be a mess. But it's book work, it's book life. Since the power draw from the Renogy will be about 160 amps continuously, and you need to use quite thick wire, so I'll be using a 35 square millimeter cable. It's only for 2 meters, so the voltage drop will be around half a volt. That's pretty acceptable, I think. So now we have the inverter hooked up in here next to the fridge. The cable is running over to the sort of power central where we have the main breakers. It's hooked up to the main breakers directly. Should we try and power things up here, see if everything blows? Negative. And okay, let's see if we got some inverter power here. On. Yep. Okay. Nice. So let's put it to the test. Now we have no power running through the system, but we have hooked up this little stove here, electric stove. So let's turn it on and see what happens. It's on. Oh, that's nice. Let's try the big one. Ooh, that's 140 amps. That's a lot. So it seems to be working. I have an electric stove in the kitchen, powered by solar power. And so tonight I'm gonna make a risotto based on solar power. The dinghy is hoisted a bit temporarily. The panels are all attached. They are plugged in, we're charging, and the need for shore power is sort of gone. I hope I never have to plug in the cable again. So it's time to go sailing now, okay? Really, we really want to get out there. So yeah, let's cross the lines and get out of here.